Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. Those who are worshiping for the first time. We continue in the season of Lent, however, this Sunday is a little bit different. This is our what we call Rose Sunday, which is the fourth Sunday in Lent. Hence, my rose, not pink, that's nice. So, special time of that where things are a little bit more upbeat during Lent. What I'd like for us to do is start out the service to get to know the person around you. If you could turn to the person, introduce yourself, and if you could take a moment to say where you see hope. Where do you see hope in the world today? So turn to your neighbor and introduce yourself and say where you see hope. Alternative occupancy criteria.
Thank you.
We say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us confess our sins to God. God of all mercy, we confess
that we have sinned against you, opposed you in the will of our lives. We have denied your goodness to each other, and ourselves, and the world we have created. We repent of the evil that enslaves us, the evil we have done, and the evil done on our behalf. The Creator restore and strengthen us, for our Savior Jesus Christ, that we may abide in the love.
Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen through all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Jesus Christ came down from heaven to be the true bread which gives life to the world. Evermore give us this bread, that he may live in us and we in him, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated.
Reading from the second letter of Paul to the Corinthians. From now on, we regard no one from a human point of view. Even though we once knew Christ from a human point of view, we know him no longer in that way. So if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting the message of reconciliation to us. So we are ambassadors for Christ. Since God is making his appeal through us, we entreat you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. For our sake he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
this fellow welcomes sinners and eats with them. So Jesus told them this parable. There was a man who had two sons. The younger of them said to his father, "Father, give me your share of the property that will belong to me." So he divided his property between them. A few days later, the younger son gathered all that he had and traveled to a distant country. And there he squandered his property in desolate living. And he had spent everything. Severe famine took place throughout the country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country, who sent him to his fields to feed the pigs. He would gladly have filled himself with the pods that the pigs were eating, and no one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, he said, "How many of my father's hired hands have bread enough to eat, enough to spare? But here, I am dying of hunger. I will get up and go to my father, and I will say, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you, and I am no longer worthy to call your son. Treat me like one of your hired hands.'" So he set off and went to his father. But while he was still far off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion. He ran, put his arms around him, and kissed him. Then the son said to him, "Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son." But the father said to the slaves, "Quickly, bring out a robe, the best one, and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Get the fatted calf and kill it, and let us eat and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found." And he began to celebrate. Now the elder son was in the field, and when he came and approached the house, he heard the music and dancing. He called one of the slaves and asked what was going on. He replied, "Your brother has come, and your father has killed the fatted calf, because he has gotten him back safe and sound." Then he became angry and refused to go in. His father came out and began to plead with him. But he answered his father, "Listen, for all these years I have been working like a slave, and I have never disobeyed your command. Yet you have never given me even a young goat so that I might celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours comes back, who has devoured your property with prostitutes, you kill the fatted calf for him." Then the father said to him, "Son, you are always with me, and all that is mine is yours. But we had to celebrate with you, because this your brother of yours was dead and has come to life. He was lost and has been found." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
About the prodigal son. At least that's the title given to him in most of the Bibles. If we look it up, those little subheadings, it says the prodigal son. Now, top quiz, what does prodigal mean? Anyone? No, not repentant. Good guess there. What?
Profligate?
No.
Returning?
Returning? Wasteful. Wasteful. Kind. Use an SAT word. I mean, wasteful. Right? So who is the wasteful son in this? The youngest one who went away?
Yes.
Many think so. Many say that what it's about is the son who went away wasted his father's inheritance. But hold on to that. You may change your mind. And there is an argument to be made that the youngest son who went away was wasteful. After all, he was given his inheritance and went and squandered it. But wasn't the father also a little bit wasteful? I mean, after all, who does that? It might be a little bit more common in this time of year, but back then, in the time of Jesus, the people that were hearing this parable, that would have been the first thing that caught their eyes. What kind of father gives his son an inheritance before he's even dead? That doesn't even make any sense. Yet, he does it. And he squanders it. And then he returns home. And many artists have tried to portray this because it's just, I can't help it, it's got to be a dramatic scene. Can you imagine, if you will, in the distance, you see your son returning, your offspring, coming back, thinking he was dead, lost, would never see him again. And this prodigal father, this wasteful father, begins to run out to him. Now, something else you may not know, it was unheard of for an older man, especially any stature, to run out to meet him. Took a lower place. And he runs out and greets him. And for those of you who also are not familiar with some of the cultural norms of that time, he hugs him. Now, there was a thing with greeting that was very important in the sense of how you greeted somebody was how they ranked. If you were equals, you would greet with a kiss. But this prodigal father takes the lower position, hugging him around his neck. And the prodigal son, the younger son comes and says, "Father, I have sinned against heaven and earth." And you notice the father's response. Doesn't blink an eye. Doesn't say a word about that. What does he say? "Get him a robe, the finest robe, and a ring, and the sandals." These are symbols of the master of the house. Things that he would be wearing as master of the house. And here this prodigal son, this wasteful son, the son who has squandered everything, comes back. And he gives him that. Perhaps this story is more about the father than it is about either of the sons. How God responds to us. As a parent, now, I appreciate this story even more. But even as a son, this story resonates. I got a glimpse of maybe just what this could possibly look like here and now with my own mother. I'll never forget it. I had come to terms with my own sexuality, and I had told a few people, but I had not told my mother. Many of you may have similar situations. I get that prodigal son rehearsing probably over and over again what he was going to say when he walked up to his father. Perhaps mouth getting a little dry, heart beating a little bit quickly, not knowing how it was going to go, how he was going to be received. So one night, after my mom had visited, she'd been there probably 1 or 2 days, I worked up the courage to do it. We were walking outside the streets of New York, real close to our seminary, and I said, "There's something I have to tell you." And to tell you the truth, I don't remember exactly how it came out. But I told her. And then we went back to the room that she was staying in and had a deeper conversation. And she began to cry. I began to cry. She began to cry. I began to cry. And there was that moment. And I don't remember what I said, but I do remember this moment. This moment that will forever be in my mind. She looked at me with tears in her eyes and she said, "You just don't get it. You don't get the love that a mother has for her child. You just don't get it. There's nothing you can do, nothing you can say that would ever make me love you less." Then I really began to cry. We embraced. We had that moment. Now I know for some of you it didn't go like that, and some people I came out to, it didn't go like that every single time. But in that moment, I got a glimpse of what grace really looks like. That when we perhaps think that we have done something wrong, and maybe we have, or maybe we haven't, we come seeking forgiveness. And then there's those times where we are that elders. Those times where we just can't accept the grace. The elder son, who is out in the field doing his hard work, comes to the door. Says, "What's going on?" The slave says, "Haven't you heard? Your brother's home. We're killing the fatted calf." His first thought is not, "Yay, my brother's home. Let's rejoice." His first thought goes to, "He got something. How dare he? Can't even get a stinking goat when this guy gets a fatted calf." Sibling rivalry is intense, but that aside, I think there's something in all of us who can relate to that eldest son, who perhaps himself is a bit prodigal. He himself was wasting what was given to him. And again, the father comes out to him and doesn't chide him. He doesn't tell him, "You're being a selfish little brat. Get your butt in that house." No. He says, "You don't get it. Everything I had is yours. I love you too, even though you're being a selfish little brat. Come into the house. Forget all this. come into the party. Rejoice. And the interesting thing about this parable, one thing I love, is the fact that we don't know whether he enters the house or stays sulking outside while the party goes on inside. We all have a choice. And if you go back to the beginning of the story, you'll remember that this was about the Pharisees complaining. Pharisees and scribes complaining that Jesus had the audacity to eat with tax collectors and sinners. He was not pure enough. Perhaps then, representing that eldest son, perhaps we could get in that mode as well. But this Jesus, who, to answer that, tells three stories. One you might be familiar with, the lost coin, the lost sheep, and now this lost son. And this one perhaps says it the best and brings it home. Because Jesus says, yeah, I eat with tax collectors and sinners. I hang out. But not just that. I give them everything. I take a lower position. I run out to meet them. I grab them. I give them sandals. I give them the ring. I kill fatted calves for them. I invite them to a feast, a party. This is the way that I'm. So there are times in our lives where I'm sure we feel like that youngest son who have lost our way. And then there's times where I'm sure we feel like the eldest son, thinking we haven't got enough or what we deserve. I was once told that every saint has a past and every sinner has a future. No matter where you sit on that spectrum, know this. Jesus is looking for you to come home. To come inside and to join the party. He'll see you if you're far off. And he'll run to greet you. And you'll embrace. And then, and only then, you truly be home. No matter where you are, it's time to come home. Amen. Mm-hmm.
Standing, let's affirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed.
We believe in one God, the Father the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God of God, light of light, true God of true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through whom all things were made, for us and for our salvation, who came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our Savior was crucified under Pontius Pilate, he suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again. looking forward to judgment of the living and dead, and this kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who in the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Have mercy on us, O God, according to your loving kindness and your great compassion. Hear our prayers.
We pray for the whole church, for Justin, Archbishop of Canterbury, Michael, presiding bishop, for Mary Ann, Bishop of Washington, for all leaders and ministers, and all the holy people of God. Wash us through and through.
And bless us for our nation.
We pray for our nation, for all the nations of the earth, and for all who govern and judge. We pray for the leaders of this and every nation. Put aside the need to have dominion over other nations, and rather follow your desires. Purge us from our sins.
And we
pray for those who hunger, those who thirst, those who cry out for justice, those who live under the threat of terror, and those without a place to lay their head. Make them hear of joy and be glad.
That those who are hungry may rejoice.
We pray for those who are ill, those in pain, those under stress, and those who are lonely. Give them the joy of your saving power.
And sustain them with your bountiful spirit.
In this season of Lent, we pray for those who prepare for baptism. And we pray that we all might be given the grace and strength to repent and grow closer to you, O God. Create in us clean hearts, O God.
And renew
the
spirit within us.
We pray for those who have died and have entered into the land of eternal life and your abiding peace. Cast them not away from your presence.
And take not the Holy Spirit from them.
O God, you open your arms to accept us even before we turn to meet you. You welcome. You invite us to forgiveness even before our hearts are softened to repentance. Hear our prayers from our lips and the prayers of our hearts that are too deep for words. Hold before us the image of our humanity made new, that we may live in Jesus Christ, the model and the pioneer of your new creation. Amen.
Amen.
The peace of Christ be always with you. Again, a warm welcome to all those who are visiting with us for the first time. Please do join us for what is going to be a well above average coffee hour. Jason Price and them also have time themselves. So please join us for coffee hour immediately after service. Go out here, make a left, keep on calling some wonderful, nice people. A couple of things going on. First and foremost, there was an online poll taken. And about when we are going to be the new worship time at our new building. I figured the building, we've done 9:30, 11 before we left, that's a free evaluation. So, by the narrowest of margins, 10:31 a.m. So, our new service time will be 10:30, happy medium between 10 and 11. So please join for that. You will all have to sleep in a little bit later once we move into our new building. A couple of things coming up, including I want to draw your attention to the planning of the funeral workshop. Again, not something everybody wants to do or necessarily wakes up in the morning and says, gee, where am I funeral? But I think it's something important to do, especially if you've been in a situation being left behind for those who have died. It's wonderful if you can have that all kind of taken care of beforehand so we can honor your wishes if it were to happen. The hike is coming up, and also draw your attention to, as I do most Sundays, to this membership. If you are interested in membership at St. Thomas, I'd like you to read this and think about this. We would love to have you. These are what we expect of our members. For those of you who have been members for a while, I'm going to ask you to recommit to this here coming up in the next couple of Sundays so you can all be on the same page really about our membership. Are there any other announcements? Finally, I'd like to end with a pastoral concern. Gene Robinson had a little accident. On Wednesday, he was getting groceries out of his car and fell into a window well. He broke his back in two places. Real bad thing on his head, too. God bless him. He, with a broken back and a busted up head, crawled out of the window well, got to his car, and made a phone call. And then waited at the end of the hour when he reached the ambulance. So I never underestimated that man before. Now I really do not underestimate him. So please just keep him in your prayers. Let him know if there's anything we can do to help out or do stuff, whatever, to stay forward. Because I think for those of you who have been with people, you know that there's a long recovery for that in order to get to where he needs to be. But again, please keep him in your prayers. We continue with our offering. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God.
Thank you.
by Mary St. Thomas that we believe that God's gracious vision and this wonderful grace of God extends an invitation to this table to all who want to receive a deeper knowledge of Christ are welcome to receive. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Give us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us.
gifts of God for the people of God. People feel the community.